standing alone in a newly created circle of hell and gazing, half hypnotized, at the disheveled beds, the stretchers on the floor, the brown blankets turned back from smashed limbs bound to splints by filthy blood-stained bandages. Beneath each stinking wad of sodden wool and gauze, an obscene horror waited for me.
In 1933, 6 years before the outbreak of another global war, a woman set down the story of her own terrible experiences in the First World War. It was an intensely personal account from a young nurse looking after the dying and wounded. Her story also drew attention to the forgotten casualties of the Great War, the women, whose lives were shattered by the devastating loss of the men they loved. The writer was called Vera Brittain. Her heart-rending autobiography, Testament of Youth, was an immediate bestseller. I first read Testament of Youth when I was a teenager, and shortly afterwards I became a nurse. Vera Brittain's account of her nursing experiences during the war is hauntingly vivid and very personal. But Vera's story isn't just about nursing. It's a heartbreakingly sad story of how one by one everybody that she loved was taken by the trenches. I've decided to retrace the steps of this remarkable woman and to try and find out what it must have felt like for someone so bright and optimistic to lose everything that mattered to her in 4 of the most brutal years in history. Growing up in Edwardian comfort before the war, Vera, like most people, could not have foreseen the carnage that would engulf her generation. In fact, she seemed well placed to have a very pleasant life. She was born in 1893 into a wealthy middle-class family. Her father owned and ran a successful paper mill, and by the time she was 12, she and her younger brother Edward were living in a large family home in the prosperous town of Buxton in Derbyshire. I've come here to meet Vera's daughter, the politician Shirley Williams, to find out more about Vera's life before the war.
Oh, my word. Oh, yes. It's enormous. Would they have had servants? Or?
Everybody would have had servants who aspired to be even vaguely middle class, yes.
How many, roughly?
I don't know how many. 3, I would guess.
That's quite a lot in my book. I haven't got any, have you?
No, of course not.
So Edward came along 2 years after...
2 years later.
Yeah, in, after Vera.
1895.
Oh, is that Edward? Oh, he's lovely,
isn't
he?
When he was first born.
In his girly outfit. She didn't resent his
arrival. No, she absolutely loved him. And she used to tell him stories, and by the time that he was about 2 and old enough to want to listen to stories, my mother would invent new stories, she'd write them down, and for about 5 years, every single evening, she would regale him with her fairy stories.
Oh, he must have absolutely loved her.
Which he loved. Yes. They loved each other, they were very close.
In Testament of Youth, Vera describes how, as children, she and her brother would take themselves up onto the Derbyshire moors to play for hours on end. They became inseparable. As Vera grew older, it was expected that she would follow the pursuits of a provincial debutante.
Obviously, some of the events were quite dressy. This is presumably going out to tea. She's 16 there.
Was she a romantic? I mean, did she actually want to get a husband, do you think? And if she did, what sort of husband?
No, I don't think by that time she was still beginning to think, I want a bit more life before I get married.
Right.
A lot of her colleagues would have got married at 17 or, well, 18 or 19, and then they would have had babies and that would have been it. But in her diary, there's some rather charming... I'll just read a little bit, if I may, of the kind of things that she felt like. This is the beginning of the year. We danced the New Year in at the Garnets yesterday evening. I'm really beginning to love dancing for dancing's sake. A few days later, I tried the turkey trots, whatever they were. We met Stella for tea at Callard's. I had on a new hat. I have no doubt Stella thought me extremely flighty. And then suddenly there's a break with all this. There was the end of that year. We went to a little dance at the Briggs's on December the 20th. Although I danced every dance hard and had what I suppose everyone would call a good time, it leaves me with a very unsatisfied feeling to have met so many stupid and superficial men.
Oh, how interesting.
So she's beginning to rebel,
isn't she? It's all beginning
there. It's all beginning.
Absolutely.
Looking for something better.
By the autumn of 1913, Vera began to realise that she wanted more from life than what she saw as mediocrity and stupid men. She wanted the experience of her male contemporaries. She wanted a career. Vera was a feminist, and so single-mindedly, she decided to try for Oxford University, shutting herself away in a small, cold room at the top of the house. Meanwhile, her younger brother Edward was in his final year at Uppingham, a public school in Rutland. Here he met two boys who would change the course of Vera's life, and though no one yet knew it, would bring her unimaginable pain and loss. I've come to Uppingham to meet the head teacher, Richard Harmon, and find out more.
In common with a lot of the public schools, of course, the OTC, the Officers Training Corps, was an important part of the school. Every boy learned how to shoot before he could take part in the rest of the extracurricular activities.
It's quite unusual.
Pretty unusual, yeah. And then a lot of it was about going on camp, parades and that sort of thing.
So who were Edward's close friends at Uppingham?
Right, well, he got particularly close to two other boys, Roland Layton and Victor Richardson. And they became known as the Three Musketeers, actually. That was the way they were referred to. And of course, you did form very intense friendships and bonds, really, in a boarding school, and particularly in a boarding house. Roland Layton was the house captain. Edward Brittain is sitting next to him, and on the other side of the housemaster and his wife, you've got Victor Richardson. So the three of them there, obviously, at the pinnacle of their house, and this was taken in July 1914.
And I suppose, given that they got the tag, the Three Musketeers, they somehow would see themselves as adventurers, swashbuckling, you know, types who would face anything, really.
I think so, and that, again, you can sort of see that in this picture here in the OTC. Again, Edward Brittain here, Roland and Victor, sitting on the box of supplies there, on one of the camps, presumably. And you can kind of see that heroic aspect to them.
Absolutely, yeah.
It comes across, doesn't it, very strongly.
Though all three boys had academic success, Roland Layton was Uppingham's most brilliant pupil. He had already won a scholarship to Oxford.
He was the editor of the school magazine as well in that year, and there's something he wrote in there too.
He was the archetypal high achiever, wasn't he, really?
He was the top scholar and obviously the golden boy of the generation.
Of the other two musketeers, Edward had also secured a place at Oxford, while Victor was heading for Cambridge. As the boys prepared for university, Europe was facing a deepening political crisis. On the 28th of June 1914, Archduke Franz Ferdinand, heir to the Austro-Hungarian throne, was assassinated. This set in train a series of events that would culminate in the First Global War. By the beginning of August, Britain would be involved, and as they approached the end of their school career, the Uppingham boys were being drilled to serve their country. On July the 11th, 1914, Vera and her mother went to Uppingham for end-of-term speech day and saw Roland pick up many of the prizes.
After the speeches, it was the headmaster's garden party held here. It was a beautiful sunny day, apparently. And Vera made a beeline for one of the musketeers, Roland.
I remember today how perfectly my dress, a frilled pink nignon with a tiny pattern, worn beneath a rose-trimmed lace hat, seemed to have been made for our chosen corner of the garden, where roses with velvet petals softly shading from orange through pink to crimson foamed exuberantly over the latticework of an old wooden trellis.
The evening after the garden party, Vera wrote in her diary, "He seems, even in a short acquaintance, to share both my faults and my talents
and my ideas in a way that I've never found anyone else to do yet. Seems as if Vera had met her love. On the 4th of August, just a fortnight after speech day at Uppingham, Britain declared war on Germany. The country was immediately gripped with excitement and nationalistic pride. Vera was no exception.
Vera was strangely excited by the news. She writes on the day war broke out, "Today has been far too exciting to enable me to feel at all like sleep.
In fact, it is one of the most thrilling I've ever lived through, though without doubt there are many more to come. That which has been so long anticipated by some and scoffed by others has come to pass at last. Armageddon in Europe."
I can't really relate to that adolescent excitement. I mean, looking back from the times that we live in now to the war and knowing how terrible it was, it just somehow seems rather inappropriate.
Field Marshal Earl Kitchener launched a recruitment campaign and young men and boys from across the country rushed to sign up. By the end of 1914, 4 months after the start of the war, over 1 million men had enlisted. And women were made part of this energetic campaign. 20,000 took a pledge to persuade every man to fight and not be seen in public with any man who was fit and free and yet had refused to respond to their country's call. In Buxton, the Brittain household was not immune to the fervour which had gripped the country. Vera was determined to do whatever she could to help.
"Today I started the only work it seems possible as yet for women to do, the making of garments for the soldiers. I started knitting sleeping helmets. I showed Edward an appeal in the Times for young unmarried men to join the army. He suddenly got very keen."
On 27th of August 1914, Vera's dream came true when she got into Oxford. Up until the outbreak of the war, she had anticipated that she would be joined there by at least two of the Uppingham Musketeers. But plans were rapidly changing as the excitement of war coursed through everyone's veins. The military training at Uppingham and public propaganda was not lost on Vera's young male friends. They were keen to enlist.
October the 9th is getting very near, but I can no longer...